environments we operate in, when you look at when we operate within the communities, we've seen 15 injuries. And again, something which is a common theme as we look, as we go through these slides, is none of them individuals are booked sick. So when somebody twinges the back, or you know, has a small cut on a finger or something, they report it because that's the culture, so that we can understand where accidents and injuries occur and lie, but actually no individuals booked sick. To help build that positive culture, we push continually near miss reporting and safety observations, okay? So something that has the potential to cause us harm in the workplace. So there's been a real drive probably over the last sort of 5-6 years now around getting our staff members to take action, to report things that have the potential to cause harm. Because if you don't report it, we don't know about it. And that incident or that occurrence in one place might be replicated in another place. And actually when they report it, myself, my team can take action to make sure, A, is it a trend? Is it a one-off? And is it something we need to address? So as you can see, a continual increase over the period. And we had 94 near-miss and safety observations. Okay, some of them will be one-off, some of them will build into a bigger picture in which my team will take action and hopefully prevent any accidents occurring. Okay, so broadly that covers off the workplace, okay, and that's around accidents and injuries. So the next one that we manage through the LPRs is road risk, as I mentioned, that's fleet. So at the point of this report being written, the service operated 228 vehicles across the whole fleet, from engines right down to light vehicles. We've covered in at least in excess of 1,000 miles, okay? It's been a bit higher than previous years, but as we moved into the early stages of the pandemic and things closed down, it was in all around just over a million miles. And that covers both blue light and routine activity. So in terms of the total figures for RTC collisions, we had 58 in 2020-21, which although was a very slight increase of 3 on the previous year from that, still remains under the predicted performance target by 14, which is equivalent to 19%. So again, this is broken down into 5 broad areas, 3 of which we report upon, 2 of which are only monitoring, okay? And this is something we monitor really closely and work really hard within the department and with the other internal departments such as legal, etc., and training to be able to ensure we are being the best and safest we can be. So you will notice in this period the predicted performance was around 28 and we come in at 34, so that was 6 above what we thought we would come in at, okay? And that's probably the major one that stands out within the figures in this presentation. Taking it with all things considered, again, when you go back to 16,000-17,000 incidents, when you go to the mobilisations and everything else, the figures, when it's sort of laid across a national picture, are relatively small. The general trend that we see on the blue light response was most of them are over 10 miles an hour, so they are low speed manoeuvres. They are not significant collisions. They are low speed manoeuvres through gaps or going slow, etc. Okay. So I think what we found was, I think 28 of those were moving forward at less than 10 miles an hour, and we clip wing mirrors or things like that as we're going through a gap on a blue light response to an emergency. Okay. Only 4 of them were over 10 miles per hour, were only very slightly. Okay, and that's something which we've worked on really, really hard through this period. I'm just reaching the conclusion of this year's annual report, hopefully next week. And there is already a significant increase in the figures that will be presented in that due to the work that's gone on in the reaction to that.
Can I just ask a very quick one on that? So are some of these accidents on purpose? Because you know, if you're going to hit a wing mirror, but you need to get the actual device through it, so it will be on purpose, don't it?
No,
is that measured as well, or is it just?
They're not generally on purpose, but in that scenario, so if I use the extreme of a house fire person being reported, and then you go down to maybe a secondary fire, a bin fire, okay, so the kind of thought process that's going on within the driver's mind and the OIC's mind is slightly different in terms of emergency. So I don't think any from what we found, if none of them are on purpose, they tend to just be a very slight misjudgment under a bit of pressure to be able to get to an instance to deal with it. But again, what I would say is that the 20 of them that we have reviewed, and we review every single one through the road risk review group, we look at the CCTV, we extract the learning, each and every one of them is generally the clipping of a wing mirror on a tight street, maybe in Everton or somewhere like that, you know, where they're trying to get to a house fire.
I mean, the point that I was making was, I don't think anybody would care if you did something on purpose.
There are some of them elements that we take into account when we look at it. What were they responding to? You know, what was the emergency, etc. So we do that data analysis to understand that, because some of these may happen. So routine activities. Okay, so this is everything that's not blue light response. This is the we're out doing. Community fire safety, turn from stations, hydrant walks, SSRIs, everything that they do within the community, in the engines, this is. Okay, and this is a really, really positive result. So 27, which was based on that incredible data I talked about, and we've come in at 14. Again, the majority of them are low speed manoeuvres, okay, and every single one is reviewed and managed. But to be kind of at least nearly half, half the predicted performance tells us that the staff are following procedures. So that was a positive one. 33 is the light vehicle responding, so this is senior officers or any specialist officers and the training school take officers out on driving. Year upon year now, for certainly as long as I've been enrolled, this has remained at zero. Okay, so again, another 0-1. On our 34, routine activity. So this is the light vehicle routine activity. So we do have a large fleet of light vehicles for advocates, couriers, workshops, etc, etc, etc. And again, where we thought the predicted performance target goes, come in at 10, and only one of them was over 10 miles an hour. So in the grand scheme of things and the mileage and everything that's undertaken, that is another positive low figure. The next two are just monitoring, so we monitor these, again, they come through road risk and we keep a view of them. So damage while stationary, so this is almost unexplained vehicle damage. So at the start of a shift, when a member of staff takes ownership of a vehicle, they will conduct what we call an A routine, so they will do an inspection of the vehicle. And upon inspecting that vehicle, they might find a dent, a broken light, etc. And you may not know the reason why. We still investigate it through road risk, so we still look at who was the last user, is there any CCTV, because we take every single one that comes in serious. But again, this is more of a monitoring one, because sometimes it's difficult to actually get to the bottom of what's occurred, but relatively low figures at 11. And the last one, you just keep a track of where other vehicles have hit us, so that's normally a conversation between myself and my legal counterpart, Caroline, in which we'll just monitor and track the ones that come in where a third party or member of the public has hit one of our service vehicles. Okay, so that's the kind of performance indicators that we're held account to, that we manage against. Okay, the bits around that we also deliver as a health and safety team to ensure the culture's right and that the place and premises is as safe as can be. So we do an annual general health and safety audit, so a member of my team who's very, very experienced and very qualified will go out to every premise, the fire station, MRU, Bestie workshops, etc, TVA, and they will do a top-to-toe kind of inspection of that building, very thorough, takes the best part of the day, and then they will provide a report and they will link into the other departments if things need addressing. So that was completed, we had 100% completion last year, which probably in light of COVID was a real success that we were able to get around and still do that. To ensure the kind of upkeep and management on stations, each station's station manager will conduct a monthly inspection, health and safety inspection of the station. So they will go around, they will look at appliances, they will look at estate, they will look at cleanliness, etc., and they will do that report. They will go around with the on-duty watch manager and address the issues there and then. And something we introduced in 2020 as the pandemic was escalating is we introduced COVID audits. Okay, so we introduced an audit for the on-duty watch manager on a weekly basis to go and do the COVID audit. Have we got enough PPE, hand gels, signage, etc., social distancing being maintained? So we went round and we did that, and that is obviously something that was progressed and was really quite important. That was fed back, and we had some of our on-the-spot HSE inspections, which they were really receptive to. So it was probably seen as what I would suggest as best practice. Okay, whistle stop tour. As I say, you've got the paper and you've got the actual annual health and safety report. The next one should be concluded in good time, hopefully some point next week. I'm happy to take any questions on that.
I'm interested in how you benchmark performance. So there's different ways you can measure your benchmarking, so whether you're going against your current or your past performance, or against external targets that have been set by some statutory authority, or if you're comparing yourself to other fire services or other emergency services. So it looks like, in terms of the injuries that are in, and also in terms of the vehicle collisions, that things are going in the right direction. But I want to know, how is that being benchmarked? Are you benchmarking against previous years within Merseyside, or against something that's being externally imposed from central government, or are you comparing yourself to the police service? Or how are you measuring whether you're doing a good job or not?
So, internally, we use a couple of sets. So the first data set we use is the empirical data of going where we've been and how are we improving. Okay, so that changes year upon year. As we get another year's data, then figures may change and we use that, and obviously you all want to kind of improve on the previous year, albeit it's been a very difficult and strange 2 years with vehicle movements up, vehicle movements down, people in, people out. So there's been a lot to kind of incorporate into that. In terms of a more broader kind of benchmark and exercise, so the national statistics, they don't really cover road risk, but they do cover national firefighter injury statistics. So something that will form in this year's report, but I do have the data on, and I sit on the regional health and safety group that feeds back into the NFCC. So I'll start with that probably. In terms of, we feed in our figures around injuries, so. And that's everything right down to the detail in terms of minor, what was it, time off work, little and portable. And that feeds into the regional group and then goes up to NFCC and you get a bit of a picture. In terms of the national statistics, so in October each year, the government will publish national statistics. And just to kind of give you a straw poll of where we were at. So in terms of the four elements that the government will publish services to benchmark themselves against, first one is proportion of firefighter injuries per 1,000 full-time equivalent population. So out of the 43 FRSs, we were seventh from bottom in terms of how many we had. So we were right up there, and actually we were the best performing Met service in terms of firefighter injuries at incidents. Talking around the training, I think it was, so in terms of training, again, we were the third lowest, and we were the lowest Met. So although I mentioned here we had five before, which is a really low number, in terms of that broader picture, out of 43 FRSs, we were third from bottom in terms of numbers, and the best performing Met. Okay, so they kind of do publish that. I think the only one where we're kind of middle of the park was firefighting injuries, completing routine activities. So that data does come in. The only, not so much problem, but kind of one of the intricacies of that data is it's not published till October, so we'll finish in April, get that in October, take stock, but we've already started then the ball rolling with our remedies and our processes to ensure we improve upon the previous year. So probably in a nutshell, to answer your question, we draw upon the internal data first, we are feed into the NFCC regional group, which feeds up to the national group to get that picture, and then I draw upon the government posted performance indicators to get a national picture of going where are we, and for a Met service in terms of where we are at, we are in an absolutely excellent position in terms of performance for health and safety.
Okay. Yeah. services as well, if not any other service. So in terms of context, again, statistics are always good. People can turn on the performance of claims described on top of us, being busy operationally, 16,000 incidents a year, probably double offer of clients moving to the short report, and then all the training events that we do as well. I think it's an outstanding result. I'm just well above the floor. I'd also say, but Craig hasn't mentioned all the way through, that is COVID. And Craig's department, which is a small team in the service, has been responsible in the main for keeping our staff safe in terms of giving guidance on how we come to work, how we operate throughout that period. And Craig was a little bit distraught that this report was late, but it's, in my view, it's completely understandable given the amount of work that hasn't been mentioned here that Craig and his team have done in the period. So I think it's an outstanding effort from our health and safety department. Our sickness to be COVID has been consistently on the lowest, no more than about 11% sickness all the way through. That's a much more part to the guidance coming off of health and safety. So just wanted to make that point here today.
I'd like to say, reading the video we were there, I don't think there are any councils or private or public-owned companies that could post the sort of figures that we've posted. It's an absolutely remarkable achievement. Couldn't believe it, actually. And especially during COVID, but any other time. I think if you had a national statistic on how many companies or councils, I don't think there's any councils here, who could boast that their councils have got the lowest rate of sickness and activity than the fire department you have there. I think that's absolutely amazing. You've done a brilliant job. But I think that's testament partly to firefighters doing the job that they do and not wanting to let those that people that need to.
Okay.
It's only a comment at the beginning, just to echo what everyone said. I do think the report and the presentation speaks for itself. Around having robust management, but also that culture around health and safety. So the information and numbers around the races, really good to see that people do come forward and report. I know you said that there's going to be a new report, so I mean, I appreciate if we could have that as soon as it's available, so that we can look at the differences around some improvements or changes that we need.
No further questions, okay, so can I just recommend that the authority note the performance outcomes of the authority against its health, safety and welfare performance targets for the period April 2021. Is that agreed? Okay, now on to agenda item 5, which is the scrutiny forward work plan. Rhea, did you want to?
Thank you, Chair. On page 37 of your agenda pack, which is the A3 pages, is the full work plan for 2020. So you can see those that aren't grayed out are outstanding and remain on the plan. This item is just a standing item, so you can see if there's anything else you'd like to add to it. It's probably worth mentioning to members as we're getting towards the end of the year and the AGM coming in June. The plan will be for the scrutiny members at the AGM to meet with officers, for officers to be able to update members as to what's going on in their relevant departments, to review this plan, what was outstanding, what you want to carry forward, and probably the priority, and anything else you'd also like to add. But if you know that there's any items you wish to add now, you can do.
Would anybody like to add anything now, or have we got anything in mind? Or don't forget, we can just get in touch with Ray at any time if you have any ideas going forward. Okay. Thank you. So we now go on to the date of the next meeting. This is the last scrutiny one of the municipal year. There's a proposed date for the next meeting, which will be the 8th of September. It's a proposed date, so we'll wait to see what happens. I mean, obviously, it's the AGM soon, and some of us may not be on this committee, but maybe other committees, whatever. But can I thank everybody, and on behalf of Jan as well, who's been the chair as well, thank everybody for attending. All
times for us to scrutinise something, which is excellent already. I mean, we've all been on scrutiny committees within our own councils, and believe you me, there is something to scrutinise, but it's very difficult when we're part of an authority which is so good.